converts us into the combustion engines and after treatment technology. I request participants to follow the instructions which I'm going to give now. I sincerely request all the participants to mute your mic and turn off the video. Post your queries in the chat section. So before I like to start, I like to give the So Mr. Dido Edison Daniel completed an UG in Garuda University and did project in nanotechnology, the topic thermophysical properties of nanofilm. He is interested in working in solar-based renewable energy. He has completed BG in Anna University, the domain of internal combustion engineering, and he has done the project in the title Performance and Emission Analysis of Pentanol Diesel Fuel Blend in Homogeneous Charged Compression Ignition. After BG graduation, he has joined in Delphi TVS. He has worked as deputy manager. Now he has been promoted to deputy senior manager and is working as deputy senior manager till now. His job role is to see the check the engine and vehicle calibration for performance and emission and after treatment. This is a short description of the today's speaker. So we are planning to give the e-certificate also after the session for the active participants. So I invite Mr. Dido Edison to take over the session. Sir, please take over the session, sir.
Hello. Thank you, sir. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
That's an audible only.
Yes. Thank you, sir, for this introduction. I'll just correct. I'm currently deputed as deputy senior engineer, not any manager.
Okay. All right, thank you, sir.
Host, can you give me a share screen?
Yes, sir. You can share, sir. Using this option, you can share your slide.
Sir, we are seeing your screen.
Yes, sir. Okay. Just now only, sir, trying to share your screen.
Okay, sir.
For me, it's showing host disabled participant screen sharing.
Sir, wait just a minute, sir. Sir, now you can able to share your screen.
Hello.
So now, unable to share your screen, sir.
No. I'm not able to share.
Yes, sir. Now we will make it. Yes, sir. Now you can do, sir. Sorry for the date.
Still not able to share. Use that Dino ME.
Dino only, sir.
Dino, yes, yes.
सर एक मिनट सर. अदरवाइज कैन यू शेयर मी सर दैट योर पीपीटी देन आई विल शो यू.
वन
ओके सर. कैन यू शेयर इन व्हाट्सएप आल्सो सर. आई मीन
மாதவன் சார்.
ஆ எஸ் சார்.
சார் இல்ல மிஸ்டர் தீனு சார் வந்து ஹோஸ்டா நீங்க கன்வெர்ட் பண்ணீங்கனா ஐ கேன் ஷேர் ஸ்கிரீன்.
எஸ் சார் ஆல்ரெடி ஐ ஹோஸ்டட் பட் நவ ஐ கேன் ஏபிள் டு. எஸ் சார் நவ ஐ கேன் ஏபிள் டு. சார் தீனு சார் நவ ஐ கேன் ட்ரை சார்.
ஓகே ஓகே.
சம் நெட்வொர்க் इश्यूज சார். थैंक यू கோபிள் சார். थैंक यू so much.
Are you able to see any presentation now?
Yes, sir. You can able to see.
Okay. Good afternoon, all. It's my privilege to share a little bit learnings whichever I learned in my PG as well as in my career to this young aspirants in KCC College. We'll start this one. There's a subject for our discussion today is advancement in internal combustion engines and after treatment technologies. The overview for our discussion today is you can see introduction to combustion engines. Just brief, almost all of your engineering students will know about combustion engines and automobile engines basically. I'll just give a brief introduction and what is actually happening inside engine. Then conventional combustion techniques in our traditional gasoline engine and diesel engine. How our spark ignition engine technology have evolved starting from carburetor technology. And then evolution of compression ignition engine, pollutant formation, which is our major talk of the subject in over the world, not only in India, but in abroad countries also. Emission reduction techniques, insulin reduction, after treatment techniques, homogeneous charge compressor ignition, RCCA, and finally summary. Introduction to combustion engines. Engine is a device which transfers one form of energy into another. And our combustion engine is a device which transfers a chemical energy into thermal energy, which in turn is converted into mechanical energy. Here the chemical energy is our regular petrol or diesel chemical compound, which is compressed or spark ignited to convert into thermal energy, which is expands, convert into energy. And this expansion, because of our piston and crankshaft design, is converted into mechanical energy. This combustion engine is two types: internal combustion engines and external combustion engines. Internal combustions are traditional spark ignition, compression ignition engine, etc. And external combustion will be your steam turbine, gas turbine, similar engines. Some of the standard internal combustion engines I have mentioned here. Some are spark ignition engine, compressed ignition engine, rotary engines, bi-fuel engines, flexi-fuel engine systems, HCCA, RCCA. The last two systems are not yet into the market yet, or into the market in a commercial way. There are one or two manufacturers who have made engines with the HCCA technology, but it has not been commercialized. Generally, we know our regular engine in market, there are SI engine and CA engines. Here, the rotary engines, we all know it is almost extinct because of its poor wear properties. And biofuel engine is a regular engine which we are using for when we fit CNG or petrol engine. What is happening in an engine? We all know that when an engine is starting, we are injecting fuel. At the same time, during the induction phase, air charge is sucked inside. When fuel and air is mixed, and based on the combustion engine, either it's spark ignited or compression ignited, combustion is initiated and it is converted to energy. And petrol, we generally say petrol, in abroad we say gasoline, is generally a composition of iso-octane chemical compound and other few other chemical compositions for better knocking properties or as well as antifreeze properties, which is a C8H18 chemical composition. It will be generally having carbon compounds from 4 to 12. And diesel is C12H23. Diesel generally has a higher carbon contents. It starts from, based on composition, it can have from 12 carbon atoms to 20 carbon atoms in a chemical composition. Oxidation of hydrocarbon fuel gives H2 and O2. This is a standard or general equation happening in a petrol engine. This occurs in case of complete combustion of chemical compound, C8H18. This is a balance equation I have given. As we see here, the products are CO2 and H2O. But in standard combustion, there is no complete combustion because the time available during for combustion is very minimum in a reciprocating engine. So there will be other pollutants as CO and HC and PM. In this equation, if you see, the input is only carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. But the pollutants coming out of an engine are NOx, COHC, SOx, sulfur dioxide, and particulate matter. You may wonder how nitrogen and sulfur is coming in place where there is no input as nitrogen and sulfur. Here the input oxygen is the fresh air supply which are supplied from atmosphere. Fresh air has around 78% of nitrogen. That is almost 3/4 of the air which is supplying inside the engine is nitrogen, and only the 1/3 of the 1/4 of the fresh charge is oxygen. So this extra nitrogen at when the combustion temperature goes to very high temperature reacts, becomes highly reactive, and it gets oxidized, and that is forming NOx. And this NOx is a very severe or carcinogenic pollutant, which is coming out of both petrol and diesel engines. As well as CO and HC are products of incomplete combustion. Sulfur dioxide are formed because of the sulfur content present in the fuel. The sulfur content is present in particularly in diesel fuel to have a better combustion stabilities. And this sulfur also, once it reacts with oxygen, oxidized and forms sulfur dioxide. And the only way to reduce sulfur dioxide is to reduce the sulfur content in the raw fuel. PM is particulate matter, which is again a form of hydrocarbon only, but it is in a physical form. I just given a little calculation to have a overview of how what is the time duration which we are dealing with respect to combustion in a IC engine. We see our IC engine, we drive any bike or car, we run at any RPM, any speed, we don't care what is happening. We are not supposed to care. That is how it is supposed to calibrate it. But actually in detail, we as an engineer, we should know in detail what is happening in our everyday components or vehicles which we are doing. See here, if consider a vehicle running at around 1500 RPM. 1500 RPM means it will have around half the cycles, 750 cycles. And here the reason why I've put 720 is the number of degrees. At 1500 RPM, engine will be covering around 2 cycles each minute. So totally 1500 into 1720 by 60 is the degree per second. And at 1500 RPM, the time taken for 1 degree of crank angle movement is 55 microseconds. That means 10 to the power of 6. And what is crank angle is, the right side, what you can see is the engine. This is engine, this is a crankshaft. And this is the flywheel or crank completely, how it is rotating. Now from top dead center to bottom center, bottom dead center, once a piston moves, this crank would have been completed one complete rotation, that is 360 degrees. And one cycle consists of 2 strokes. That means it would have covered 720. So at one compression stroke from bottom dead center to top dead center, that is how compression stroke happens. And in that, it will be covering only 180 degrees of crank movement. This 180 degree of crank movement will be equivalent to 9.9 millisecond at 1500 RPM. It is this time duration is specific to engine RPM. So I mentioned RPM specifically. The reason why I mentioned this timing is that the inter compression time is 9.9 milliseconds or 1500. As we increase the time, as we increase the engine RPM, the time duration available for compression reduces. And similarly for intake air charging, and for every activity, as the RPM increases, our time duration reduces. Once the time duration reduces, we are supposed to happen at higher time duration, the combustion phenomenon, which is physical phenomenon, which will take the same time duration irrespective of engine operation, will be affected based on this short availability of time duration at higher RPMs. So this time duration will be influencing our pollution formation and pollution engine out pollutions. So conventional combustion techniques in gasoline combustion. BE students mostly will be initially starting with the 2-stroke, 4-stroke types of engines, types of combustion strokes, air intake, air compression, power stroke, and expansion stroke. Now I'm discussing about the combustion cycle alone, the time duration happening between compression stroke and expansion stroke. In SI engine, fuel is injected at the port or in the before in a carburetor engine, it will be injected close to our throttle body. The injector fuel, I'll just see. So if you see the right hand side, say our left side portion is the intake port, and this is the exhaust port, this is a spark plug. Our fuel will be injected around this place in a port injector. It will be coming inside. As the suction phase starts, the air and fuel gets mixed and a homogeneous mixture is formed. Once spark is ignited, fuel gets ignited and the flames start propagating. And there are three stages in SI combustion: ignition lag, propagation of flame, afterburn. Here, this ignition lag is a phase when in the left hand side, I'll just explain the brief about describe about the diagram first, then go into the details. The y-axis is the pressure curve, the pressure inside the cylinder. X-axis is the crank angle. 0 degree being top dead center. Top dead center means, so 60 degree here, 60 means 60 degree before a top dead center in the compression phase. And the line which I'm showing, AB, and this dotted line, below line, is a motoring curve. Motoring curve is the curve if the piston is, or piston or crank is automatically rotating and there is no power is generated in the engine. In that case, it is referred as a compressor. So it just compresses the air and goes off. Same compressor event, when there is a power stroke, it produces energy and that energy is converted into mechanical force. Here, in a SI combustion, the homogeneous charge is inducted in the suction phase and being compressed here till say 20 degrees. And around 18 to 20 degrees in this diagram, if you see, spark is ignited by the spark plug. At this time, the entire chamber, cylinder chamber, is having a homogeneous fuel mixture. The spark is ignited, but there will be a time delay in the start of combustion. This time delay is mentioned as ignition lag. Even though ignition has been inducted, there is no spark, there is no fire, there is a delay. But during the delay, our piston starts still further moves towards the top dead center, goes around 10 degrees. And at the point B, there is a combustion of entire homogeneous mixture starts. And temperature is increases, the fuel charge is expands, the pressure increases. And that you can see in point from point B. From point B, there is a pressure rise is there. And pressure rises going up to around 30, depends on the fuel quantity which we are injecting. And from point B to point C is the zone where flame propagation happens. The flame propagation happens can be explained here in the right side diagram. This is the flame. This is almost like maybe 30 to 40% of fuel is being burnt here. And this flame propagation will be starting from close to the spark plug. It will start receding from spark plug and goes to the base of the piston. Now this, as the flame is propagated, air mass increases because air expands, because of chemical reaction and high fuel oxidation reaction, air mass increases and expansion of gas happens inside. And pressure is built up. That pressure is being captured in and being displayed here. Once the entire homogeneous mixture is burnt, the pressure inside the cylinder burns. Pressure inside the cylinder starts reducing, and which is mentioned as afterburn. And the main summary of SI combustion is homogeneous charge and flame propagation. Next is compression ignition. Similar to SI engine, only difference between SI and the CI engine is the fuel is not being inducted in the suction stroke itself, but it will be injected in the end of compression phase. There are four stages in compression ignition combustion. It is ignition delay, premix combustion, diffusion combustion, and late combustion. Similar to ignition delay in ignition lag in SI engine, ignition delay is a phase when the fuel is injected, but there is no heat release or no pressure rise. But there will be a small time when the fuel and air mixes and it gets oxidized, but there is no temperature rise. And after a delay, the pre-mixed fuel gets starts combustion instantaneously, and that instantaneous pressure rise is mentioned as termed as pre-mixed combustion, and that will be happening in this case between 0 to minus 10 or minus 8. And after that, once the premix fuel is burnt, still in the upper phase, you can see the fuel is being injected. This injector fuel won't have proper time for mixing with the air. So these fuel injected in this phase will have a combustion property of fuel will be in a mixed, semi-mixed state of liquid state. So the burnt, we cannot actually exactly say it is a homogeneous mixture. That's why it's called deficient mixture, and it's also called as droplet combustion. Here in the top first diagram, you can see this is injection from a single hole of an injector. This is zone where our fuel is injected at high pressure, our rail pressure, our fuel pressure, whether in modern cars. Our injector is close to around 1600 to 1800 bar. In our regular standard mechanical injector, we go up to 180 bar to 250 bar. And now, once this fuel is injected, initially it will be in high liquid phase. And over a period of time, because of excessive turbulence, fuel and air mixes, and the green color region will be the very lean zones where the AFR will be slightly higher than stoichiometric AFR. And the orange zone will be the zones where our AFR will be exactly equal to stoichiometric AFR, and it will have best combustion and high temperature zones. And the below diagram shows the first phase is the premix combustion. The premix combustion heat release rate will be maximum, and fuel burning in the diffusion phase will be progressive, the rate of heat release will be slightly less than premix phase. This is the conventional combustion engine, S engine. That is a place where spark is ignited. So flame propagation happens and combustion stop. This is a place when fuel is injected. This was zones when liquid fuel, and this is zones when fuel and air is completely mixed together, and because of favorable condition, fuel is being burnt simultaneously. And this is the evolution of SI engine. We know we are still have some two wheelers, still BS4. We are almost all vehicles were having carbureted petrol engines. In BS2 stages, obviously one stage, our vehicles were having carbureted engines, but we have moved from carburetor to throttle body injection, to manifold injection, to port fuel injection, and gasoline. And the future of SI engine will be gasoline direct injection. We have not yet in India. We are not yet fully commercialized gasoline direct injection yet. There are a few OEMs have manufactured GD engines which are expensive. You are expensive in a way that is expensive than petrol diesel engines. And all these changes will be based on the way how fuel is being injected. And this is how evolution of compression ignition. There is no much difference in over a period of time, but the how we are building the rail pressure, how much rail pressure we are going, that have changed over a period of time. Initially, we had a pre-mixed combustion chamber where the fuel will be mixed in a small chamber before the actual chamber, and that chamber will be heated either by glow plug or external means. and thereby combustion will be starting there. And from there, we have gone to direct injection with respect to inline pump, then rotary pumps, then we move to unit pump systems, and now currently in CRD. Pollutant formation. Most of the significant or very severe pollutants are NOx, HC, PM soot, and CO. NOx is, I mentioned here, how NOx is formed in SI engine and C engine. NOx formation in SI engine is based on flame propagation. The gases which are burnt at the initial phase of spark ignition, when the spark is ignited, those gas will be converted into the final products. But later stage, once the final products are burnt, there will the pressure increases inside the cylinder, and thereby the temperature also increases. As the temperature increases, NO is because of high reactivity at high temperature, NO is formed. And reason for NOx generation in C engine is, like I mentioned before, at the lean flame out region where the AFR is slightly leaner than stoichiometric, the temperature of gas will be very high, around 1500 Kelvin, which is a favorable condition for NOx formation. And NOx is a gas, NOx we generally say is a mixture of NO and NO2. In SI engine, generally NO2 will be very minimum, and most of the NOx will be NO only. But in SEA, NO2 will be around 20-30% of the total NOx produced. Hydrocarbon is the reason for hydrocarbon emission in a petrol engine is because of flame quenching at the walls. The flame propagation through the towards closer walls will have a cooler temperature, which will result in flame quenching. Fuel in crevices are the area between the piston and piston rings, those regions where a proper flame or proper combustion will be happening. Those gases which are trapped there during exhaust phase will be expelled out, or will be coming out as hydrocarbon. Similar to crevices area, absorption of fuel vapor by oil on the walls. Adsorption during the suction phase and desorption during the exhaust phase also creates hydrocarbon emissions. Also, one more main reason for hydrocarbon is incomplete combustion during AFR. Stoichiometric of petrol is around 14.6 AFR. When we go richer to stoichiometric AFR or too lean than stoichiometric AFR, there is a chance for hydrocarbon emissions. For CA engine, locally over lean mixture during ignition delay period. During the initial ignition delay period, whenever the mixture formation having very lean mixtures, there is a chance for HA emissions. From PM and soot, since SI engine will be running in a lean, completely homogeneous mixture, it will be having a minimum PM emission. For CA emission, the diesel fuel is a heavier fuel and the vaporization is lesser, and the time fuel is being injected at the compression end of compression with the time duration available for complete burning of carbon is minimum, and that by result in soot formation during similar to HC. When the AFR is richer conditions, the PM and soot formation will be higher. That is why in on-road condition, whenever we see heavy trucks with fully loaded payload, they will be flushing out more of visible soot. CO, a richer operation and minimum CO pollution for SI engine, and for compressed ignition, diesel engines run in very lean CO emissions, so minimum CO emissions. So these are the emissions, and our government has formed strict emission norms to limit these emissions for our own safeties. And these are the conditions based on which emission can be reduced. In-cylinder emission emission reduction techniques and after-treatment reduction techniques. In-cylinder are, we try to reduce the pollution in the source of forming itself. After-treatment of, there are certain pollution which can be reduced for, or which are post-treated after the engine. These have come under after-treatment. In-cylinder techniques are EGR, after injection, retarder injection, swole port design, piston bowl design, valve timing, low temperature compressions. Though swole port, piston bowl, and valve timing are not fixed once our engine is manufactured, other EGR and after injection timing will be varied depending on the engine operation conditions. EGR is exhaust gas recirculation. Yeah, exhaust gas recirculation is a phenomenon by which we are recirculating the burnt exhaust soot mass, into the engine, thereby reducing NOx emission. How it is achieved is exhaust gas has CO2, C1, H2O, which have very high thermal capacity, the ability to absorb heat. So compared to normal engine operation, once our air and fuel charge has extra exhaust gas, where CO2 and H2 is increased, and during combustion, the rise in temperature will be absorbed by the exhaust gas, and thereby the peak temperature will be reduced, and reducing NOx emission. And this EGR, all these techniques which I am mentioning here are practically being followed by OEMs, and EGR is a primary emission which was implemented around BS4, BS3 emission norms to comply with our government norms. And after injection, final stage of diesel combustion, which I mentioned, is a zone where majority of hydrocarbon and soot will be formed. So with respect to CRDA, advancement in CRDA technology, we have flexibility in injecting at a different timing, and thereby after the proper combustion is over, we manually inject extra pulse of fuel so that whatever leftover soot will be burnt off. Retarder injection, in single injection phase, where in place of mechanical pumps, inline pump or rotary pump, there's no flexibility of injection. And at certain loads, we are forced to inject at a very advanced phase so that because ignition delay will be accounted and fuel will be burnt at close to top dead center. But with the advancement of CRDA technologies, we can inject pilot fuel so that a proper charge will be prepared, and the main injection can be retarded post top dead center, so that similar to higher temp, the pressure formed inside the cylinder will be reduced, and thereby the temperature, peak temperature, and thereby the NOx emission also can be reduced. Swole port design, piston bowl design, valve timing. Swole port design and piston bowl design are initial simulation trials which any engine manufacturers will be testing before they go for final hardware finalization. And these two swole port and piston bowl geometry changes the turbulent formation which is formed inside the SIC engines. Thereby the fuel mixing property will adjust it. Valve timing and petrol engine are in the initial itself. I told we have timing issues at very high speeds. There is a time available for the complete suction stroke or compression stroke is very limited, and thereby the volumetric efficiency of a petrol engine at higher RPM is very poor. In order to optimize that, they have come up with valve timing change in valve timing so that at a higher engine RPM the camshaft will be adjusted so that the intake port will be open for more duration compared to a lower engine RPMs. The final one is low temperature combustion. Identify based on research work, we identified that the reason for NOx formation or PM particulate matter formation are because of diffusion combustion or change difference in state of the fuel. So to overcome that, we have identified a homogeneous combustion will be the best solution, and based on that we are arrived at HCCI and RCC technique. Emission reduction with respect with after treatment techniques. After treatment, as I mentioned, post pollution generation in the engine, we can reduce pollution with the previous all these techniques to a limited level. Post that, our optimization level has been limited. Now this pollution is coming out of engine, but our government norms are now regulating or finalizing the engine out emission as well as vehicle out emissions. So we have to comply with those emission norms. So automakers and OEMs have come up with the following after treatment techniques and components. Some are oxidation catalyst, NOx catalyst, three-way catalytic converters, LNTSCR and DPF. Oxidation catalysts are used to oxidize CO and HCl to form final products. And the catalysts used for oxidation are platinum palladium. They increase the reaction of the CO-HC compound at very low temperature itself. But still, CO and HC generally converts at around 500 to 700 degrees Celsius. But with the addition of platinum palladium material, by around 250 to 300 degrees Celsius itself, we can convert CO-HA. The only disadvantage is that only at the temperature for this conversion is very limited to 250 to 350 zones. Should be minimum to of 250, or else the conversion won't be properly happening, and engine out emission itself will be directly observed in tailpipe of the vehicle. This temperature is known as light out temperature. There is a negative it is influenced in a negative way by the fuel property of the fuel quantity, fuel composition used. Lead is an anti-knock agent used in petrol, and phosphorus is oil additive. These two chemical compounds pollute the rare earth elements present in the oxidation catalyst, platinum and palladium. So if you are going for after treatment technique which uses oxidation catalyst of platinum and palladium, the fuel property or the fuel composition should not have lead and phosphorus. Now you will be knowing the gasoline fuel which you are using is unleaded petrol. You'll be seeing from petrol stations. That means the lead content has been removed. That is what it means. And this is a technique used in DOC, diesel oxidation catalyst, which is used in diesel vehicles. NO reduction. We saw the NO formation before. This NO reduction can be optimized by, or reduction happens readily in the presence of these following chemical these rare earth elements, starting from rhodium, palladium and platinum. And this rhodium will has a oxidizing or poisoning quality, so majority of the OEMs are not going for rhodium, but RH is rhodium is the compound currently used in the industry. A three-way catalytic converter, It's a combination of oxidation catalyst and NOx catalyst used in petrol vehicles. Straightway catalytic converter has a limitation of running at richer condition. But in SI engine, we normally run at stoichiometric AFR. So since we both go hand in hand, we are using three-way catalytic converter. And this three-way catalytic converter has been in market or in our regular production vehicles, any petrol vehicles, from I think PS3 itself. LNT. LNT is Lennox trap. In a diesel engine, since our engine operation is a lean operation, unlike petrol engine, which operates at only stoichiometric AFR. Lean operation, I'll just give a definition of lean operation. Lean operation is an engine operation where our global AFR will be very higher than stoichiometric AFR. In diesel engine, our AFR will be normally from 16 to 10 based on engine loading. So since our engine operation is lean, we cannot use a traditional three-way catalytic converter. We need to have a specific technology that we have evolved for Lennox trap. Lennox traps absorbs the NOx generated during the lean phase. Right side, you can see this is an example of how Lennox traps works. And there is a barium oxide chemical compound at the surface. And this lean LNT will be present. I'll just give the location. It will be present at the tailpipe of engine. If a turbocharged engine, it will be after turbocharger or before turbocharger, depends on the feasibility study. And this, once the burnt or exhaust gas comes towards this LNT, barium oxide absorbs the NO gas present during the lean phase. And once this the absorbing efficiency goes to saturation, we are manually supposed to bring our engine to a rich operation, that is around 14.5 richer condition, so that this NO will be reduced to N2. That is what I have explained here. And this conversion, the reason for bringing it to a richer condition is for this reduction reaction, we need higher CO content. Next, one more method of bringing down NOx reduction out of a vehicle is SCR. SCR uses urea. This is a exhaust gas coming out of engine, which will be having NO and NO2. Urea will be injected just before the SCR. This urea will be converted to ammonia. This ammonia and NO reacts and forms NO2 and N2 and O. And that's how NO will be reduced with respect to SCR. And this is a NOx reduction technique used in majority of commercial vehicles, where excess of exhaust flow or volume flow of exhaust will be very high generally in normal operation itself. And this SCR technology has not yet come or has been in certain one or two commercial vehicles in BS4. And most of commercial vehicles in BS6 will be having SCR technology. And DPF, we have only one particulate matter filtering technology, that's DPF. A PM, which is a significant issue, cost in 1 minute. DPF, diesel particulate filter, traps the PM and soot generated by the engine. We have only one after trip technology to trap this PM and soot. Right side, you can see how a general DPF will be. DPF will be a honeycomb structure where one end of the, there will be multiple channels, and certain channels will be blocked upstream and certain channels will be blocked at the downstream. And this is upstream starting of the phase, and this will be the downstream. And as the reason for this blocking or clamping of the channels is to increase the cross flow of exhaust gas. Exhaust gas with particulate matter, once it crosses this special material, ceramic material, it will be the PM will, it will have a very finite very small diameter of a diameter hole. It will be in the order of micrometers. As the exhaust gas flows through the path, that PM will this is a particulate matter. It has two functions: soot trapping, and soot regeneration. Since it's a filter, once soot accumulation has been increased to a certain level, the back pressure will be higher. If the engine back pressure is higher, and the pressure ratio across which the engine operates is reduced, and thereby reducing the engine efficiency. Now, so this trapped soot should be removed. For this, we use a regeneration technique. Regeneration technique is to.
I think, sir, you can mute that Mr. Sudhiran. Dinu sir.
Yes.
I think you can only able to do, sir. And also some people also waiting in that admit. So put admit also.
Yes. Okay. So the two parts of a DPF will be soot trapping and soot regeneration. Once the soot soot accumulation increases to beyond a certain level, the back pressure increases because of it, and because of that, engine operation efficiency itself drops. For that to remove the soot, we need to burn off the soot. Soot is nothing but the hydrocarbon fuel, which is of higher geometry or higher size. The diameter of the soot will be in a bigger state. With carbon and hydrogen composition. So once the temperature of this DPF is increased, this soot starts burning, and that is called as soot regeneration. Soot regeneration is of converted as of two types: active regeneration, passive regeneration. Active regeneration is we are forcing the DPF to increase to a certain temperature. Then industry standards is around 600 to 620 degrees Celsius, at which the trapped soot mass is burnt. So if we are manually forcing to increase the temperature, it is called as active regeneration. And based on normal engine operation itself, if the soot is being burnt, it is called passive regeneration. And this passive regeneration can be happening because of high engine operation. Same like a truck. If I take a truck example, if the truck is running at a very high load with 10 tons of a load capacity, it will be having a very high exhaust temperature normally in normal operations. In those kind of situation, this soot will be burnt in without any special activity. And this one more point in active regeneration. We can increase the temperature either by injecting a fuel separately to increase the temperature, or there are certain DPFs which has an electrical heater across the DPF. which will increase the temperature and soot will be burnt. And now low temperature combustion. There are two techniques in low temperature combustion. One is homogeneous charge compression, other one is reactivity control compression ignition, HCC compression. Both these combustion techniques are new combustion techniques with which the research is still being under progress, and we have not come to a final conclusion, and we have not it has not been commercialized yet. And the idea behind homogeneous charge compression ignition is homogeneous charge is auto ignited and thereby the energy is being absorbed. I'll just give I'll show how it is being done. You could see there is you can see the flames coming up, but you cannot see how or where it starts, when it starts. This is the idea of homogeneous charge. There is no particular start, and there is a point or source in which the combustion is initiated, and there is no flame propagation, and thereby there is no diffusion combustion, or there is no change in AFR across a different state. So that way, the combustion inside the cylinder will be uniform and instantaneous, and the heat addition will not be over a period of time, similar to SI engine. It will be instantaneous, and thereby the max temperature will be lesser. This homogeneous charge compression can be achieved by some of the techniques to achieve homogeneity is port injection, early injection or late injection. Port injection, if it is a volatile fuel, at normal atmosphere pressure itself, it will be evaporated. But if it is a diesel, we need to have a special technique to vaporize the fuel. Or else, early injection technique. At the start of time, only the reason for homogeneous, the condition to form homogeneity is the time availability for air and charged fuel to mix. In diesel injection, since we are injecting at the end of compression stroke, compressed air itself will be in a ready-mix state to start compression. That the temperature will be higher. That is the reason why we are ending up in higher NOx and NOx emissions. So in order to tackle that, if we inject multiple phases prior to the earlier combustion phase, we can have a homogeneous mixture, or the time available for air and fuel to mix will be higher. Thereby, homogeneity can be achieved. Or late injection, it is similar to the retarded injection which we spoke earlier. HCC compression engine in gasoline engines. It improves the advantages and some of the ideas. It improves the fuel economy of gasoline engines. There is significant reduction in NOx emission because of controlled temperature and pressure and composition of air. Due to absence of spark, there is no direct ignition timing. So the combustion phasing will be automatic or based on chemical reaction or chemical oxidation of fuel and air mixture. Auto ignition of premixture is simultaneous without flame front propagation. Earlier we saw in SI engine there is a flame front which is propagating from spark plug. In HCC engine there is no flame front, there is no flame propagation, so that there is no temperature accumulation inside the temperature accumulation over a period of time. So thereby that the temperature, max temperature, will be lesser. in addition to the multiple addition to homogeneous combustion, initiation of combustion at multiple sites is observed in HSA. The disadvantage is when load is reduced, CO and HC increases in HSA engines. And this is the comparison between the emission formation in S engine and C engine. There is a major disadvantage in HC engine is HC, hydrocarbon, which at least we have after treatment technique to reduce. But the significant advantage in HC engine here is NOx, which has been reduced to a significant level. We can hear the standard S engine, it is around 6 grams per kilowatt hour. But in C engine, it is 0.05 to 0.25 depending on the engine load. Similar to in gasoline, HCC in diesel also has the proper function of reducing PM and NOx. PM, in fact, the advantage is more in diesel engine because it simultaneously reduces both emissions. That combustion technique is low temperature combustion and homogeneous charge. And identifying the reasons for higher emission in conventional systems, deficient combustion. Deficient combustion ends up use end of injection, richer fuel, and higher smoke due to the absence of excess air. Because of it, charge formation time is reduced. And also, the momentum supplied by the injector ceases at the end of fuel injection. So the mixing reduces and the AFR becomes richer. And that's why an NOx suit is formed. This is the reason that means diffusion or phased out different phase of or richer air fuel mixture is observed in conventional combustion. That's why PM is formed. If we are able to tackle this, we will be overcoming PM emissions. That is what is achieved here. The challenges in HCCA is homogeneous mixture formation, ignition of the mixture, and control of combustion power optimization. A homogeneous mixture, if it is a volatile fuel, we can easily have a vaporous form, and thereby fuel air mixture won't be a problem. But diesel being having a high vapor point or boiling point cannot be evaporated, or so homogeneous mixture formation is a challenge for diesel fuel, which is achieved either by high multiple injection with the CRDA technology. Ignition mixture, a creation of homogeneous source for starting the combustion, but relies only auto ignition of the mixture, which is not predictable. In this technology, it does not have a source for ignition. It should automatically, chemical reaction should achieve a proper state and combustion should happen. At the same time, this combustion should happen close to DDC. If this combustion is happen quite advanced than DDC, there is a chance for knocking and engine ceasing also. If it is happening very away from top dead center, the efficiency of combustion reduces. The efficiency of mechanical energy transferring to the flywheel reduces, and thereby reducing the entire efficiency of the combustion itself. So the ignition facing is a significant challenge in HCC engine. Because of this, there is one more combustion technique, which is advanced form of homogeneous air combustion. This is RCCA combustion. It is reactivity controlled combustion ignition. This uses two fuels. RCCA uses in-cylinder fuel blending with at least two fuels of different reactivity and multiple injection to control in-cylinder fuel reactivity optimized combustion. The two fuels will be, one fuel will be homogeneously charged, and which will be of low which will be evaporating very much easily. This will be a port injector, and this evaporated fuel will be burnt by giving a multiple injection or a small pile of injection, so that the chemical reaction can be quite activated manually. You can see here, if you see in the top blue line, blue is the pressure pressure release, the red is the rate of heat release. In the rate of heat release, you can see around 15 degree minus 15 before the top dead center, you can see a small peak. That means a small quantity of heat is released here, and this heat will be helping other homogeneous earth of petrol or gasoline engine gasoline fuels to form oxidize and readily form a mixer, and it starts active reaction at close to 30 TDC. And by optimizing this chemical reaction happening in these zones, we can have the best engine out efficiency. And this gray is fuel injection, which is used to control the combustion. Now this is a first injection, but at the same time there is the suction phase will be sucking or inducting air and fuel from the port. So during the homogeneous charge itself, we are injecting a primary diesel injection, and this is a secondary injection which will be actively start chemical reaction here. So in the secondary reaction is the zone where chemical reaction is activated, but there is no heat release. And now out of nowhere, combustion starts automatically. That means at this state, the entire chemical composition is oxidized and is ready to combust. And this is a homogeneous combustion which happens instantaneously, and thereby the efficient, we can get the best engine out efficiency with the lesser emissions. And this RCC happens in a three stage cool flame reaction. First energy release and final energy release state. Cool flame is the zone where which I mentioned here. Primary heat release, which will be supporting or influencing other chemical reaction, and thereby premix combustion happens, and that premix combustion burns off or increases the engine temperature to burn the other leftover homogeneous charge mixture, low reactor mixture, and thereby this is a rate of heat release. The heat rate, this is what we need, the rate of release to be high, very high, continuously over the period of time at the top dead center itself, unlike the rate of heat release in traditional compression ignition engine, which is very high at the initial phase and a very low rate of heat release towards the secondary diffusion phase. The strategies used in RCC are fuel reactivity certification, equivalence ratio certification, temperature certification. Fuel reactivity certification means the reactivity of the fuel will be different. In the combustion, reactivity of the fuels used will be different. That means in the port, fuel injection will be low reactive fuel, and the diesel fuel will be high reactive fuel. Reactivity here means the ability to oxidize. Since a low reactive fuel, that means gasoline, though it has high or lower volatility, it has high auto ignition temperature. That means the ability to react at lower temperature is poor. That is why it is called low reactivity. RCC uses both low reactivity and high reactivity fuel at the same time. Equivalence ratio is another form of air-fuel ratio. the air fuel ratio used, though the universal or the global will be linear, combustion start, there will be a spot in which the combustion starts. That zone will be close to stoichiometric, and the other global zones will be lean zones. And temperature stratification, and the temperature at the source will be around the maximum, and the zones towards other zones will be lesser compared to start of combustion zones. And thereby, with all these techniques, we can have a low temperature combustion with the lower PM and NOx emissions. Advantages: low temperature combustion has lower incident and NOx generation, minimum PM generation, particulate generation, higher engine operation range, lower hydrocarbon compared to HCC engine, but still RCC has a HCC emission higher than conventional engine. Summary. This is all about today's research. And summary is based on our advancement in electronic control, telematics, material and mechanical properties, coating technology, etc., has led to this development in society and sophistication in everyday life. We are having a very modern, quiet, good life, but the quantity of technology advancement, the advancement which we are using every day, we are, if we start analyzing, there is a quite a long research work that been happening for a period of 10-15 years. That's why we have come here. Now, after treatment, the scope on research is emission conversion, call efficiencies, that way HC to CO, HC to H2O conversion efficiency can be improved. Temperature of operation, the zone, temperature zone in which it is being operated can be improved by research. As there is a low temperature combustion, that means advanced combustion technique, the range, the one of the main the problem is that can be that there is a scope for research there, and low temperature combustion has lower exhaust temperature, for which we need to separate after treatment technologies.
Is a slide over?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Okay. So, any queries we can ask. Also, you can put text also. I hope we okay. We are almost. We are more around the running out of time. And first of all, I apologize my mistake. Unfortunately, same name added the another person as a host, so that I can't able to so make it as host for our today chief guest. And so due to some technical problem, some participants cannot able to join also. So behalf of our management and department of our automobile department, so we give a sincere thanks to our today chief guest Mr. Dino. And actually most of the time we are worked together in our anonymity laboratory, in ICE engine laboratory. We did so many projects also. And thanks our director ma'am and associate dean ma'am and principal for encouraging to do a so series of automobile webinar. And I thanks to all the participants for attending today webinar, and also I'm sure that's a mistake and all here, it won't happen again. And thank you very much, everyone.